Shalom. Welcome back to Issachar Forum, a prophetic think tank, video version. And we're glad you're here. Let us begin with a word of prayer, and then we'll get into the news for this week. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your faithfulness, and we thank you, Lord God, that you are restoring and rebuilding Israel and Jerusalem. You are the faithful God, Jehovah, and we honor you and bless you. Thank you for your son, Yeshua ben Jehovah, Jesus, the Son of God. In his name we pray. Amen. Well, as usual, I'd like to point you to my blog. It's found at www.elishavision.wordpress.com. And I want to mention the latest blog I posted, the title of which is Commander of the Straw Man Army. Now, I have to admit that one of the perks of writing your own blog is that you get to make cute little titles up for your essays. And I thought this one was particularly descriptive of President Obama. If you have observed him over the years, you'll probably know yourself and have observed that he hardly ever answers a hard question directly. He actually answers it by raising up a separate kind of different argument about something a little bit over to the side. It kind of distracts from the main question and sets up this straw man, which he can then easily defeat. And it sounds like he's answering the question with authority and so forth, and yet he never answered the question. Well, that's particularly evident this week. And I wrote about it. My first line of the essay was, President Obama is adept at using a straw man to shift an argument from the real issue to one he can easily refute. It's a form of sleight of hand. He's made an international incident over the invitation for Prime Minister Netanyahu to address a joint session of Congress on March 3rd. And I actually give a definition in here of what a straw man is, and then talk a little bit about this, about basically what he has done is raise up this issue. He's charged Netanyahu with a breach of protocol simply because Speaker Boehner of the House U.S. House did not consult the White House. It had nothing to do with Netanyahu. In fact, the official invitation to Netanyahu says it was a bipartisan joint invitation of Congress, Republicans and Democrats, to come and speak to Congress in the Senate and the House in a joint session of Congress. And that was the invitation that Netanyahu accepted. It in no way was a partisan Republican or anything, but it would prove to be when he does come and speaks, he will be speaking against the U.S.-led effort to allow Iran in the negotiations to develop a nuclear weapon. So, what Obama's really upset with, and what he's really fighting, is anybody who speaks out against his plan to give nukes to or allow nukes to be built in Iran, and therefore he created this side issue about protocol in order to try to fight it. Well, that's kind of in a nutshell. You can read my blog if you want to get a little more detail about it. The second reason they gave, another straw man, they said they wouldn't attend the president, the vice president, Secretary Kerry. Now some 40 Democrats say they may not attend the speech on March 3rd when Netanyahu speaks to Congress. And that is just breathtaking in its hypocrisy, because the excuse they gave is that they do not meet with other leaders during elections, since the Israeli election is March 17th. They say that's too, it becomes a political thing, and they don't want to appear to be supporting one side or the other. And yet, as you follow the news, you realize that the top campaign manager for President Obama is now working full-time for the opposition in Israel. The head of the opposition party is Herzog. And I wrote an update on my blog since I published it, saying that Vice President Biden just yesterday met with Herzog, the opposition leader to Netanyahu, in Munich after announcing that he would boycott the prime minister's speech before Congress. And yet they claim they don't want to influence the election. And that's just a bold-faced lie. The administration is directly and indirectly doing everything they can to try to defeat Bibi Netanyahu in the March 17th elections. We need to really be praying into that hard. pray that the enemy's camps will be confused and that God's purpose will be accomplished. And that's what I'm praying for. And the scripture that I put along with this in the blog was, I'll read a little portion of it from Zechariah 12. "Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of drunkenness to all the surrounding peoples when they lay siege against Judah and Jerusalem. And it shall happen in that day that I will make Jerusalem a very heavy stone for all peoples. All who would heave it away will surely be cut to pieces, though all nations of the earth are gathered against it. In that day, says Jehovah, I will strike every horse with confusion and its rider with madness. I will open my eyes on the house of Judah and will strike the horse of the peoples with blindness. And the governors of Judah shall say in their heart, the inhabitants of Jerusalem are my strength and Jehovah of hosts, their God. In that day I will make the governors of Judah like a fire pan in the woodpile and like a fiery torch in the sheaves. They shall devour all the surrounding peoples on the right hand and on the left, but Jerusalem shall be inhabited again in her own place, Jerusalem." And then I finished with a simple question. Is Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu that fiery torch? I pray for him that God will use him and that he will follow the will of God. Well, hallelujah. That's you can tell I'm a little fired up about all this kerfuffle going on and the false accusations and the really underhanded involvement of our administration in the Israeli elections, while at the same time saying they're above that and they never do that. What breathtaking hypocrisy. I think that's the right phrase to describe that. Well, let's get on with some of the news. There's other things going on. Oh, I did want to just quote the actual invitation that John Boehner sent out to Netanyahu. Quote, "It is my honor on behalf of the bipartisan leadership of the U.S. House of Representatives and the U.S. Senate to extend to you an invitation to appear before and address a joint meeting of Congress." So there you go. That was the invitation. It was bipartisan, and it's a lie to say that it was a partisan invitation. Just because the White House is using this protocol thing. I mean, even if it was a breach of protocol, let it go. Let it go. President Obama is no big deal. And, of course, Obama refuses to meet with him even when he's in Washington. Biden is not going to attend the speech. You know, just shameless treating of our best allies in the Middle East, our friends Israel. Well, meanwhile, one of the big things, of course, of the week was, and this was all over our news in the States here, about the burning alive of the Jordanian pilot by ISIS. And that's been plenty on the news. And yet, how did the United Nations respond to that? The United Nations actually condemned the Hezbollah missile attack. This is a separate incident, but the other incidents from last week, when two Israeli soldiers and a Spanish UN man were killed on the Golan Heights by Hezbollah from Syria, the UN actually condemned the killing of the UN guy, but didn't condemn the killing of the Israeli soldiers that died in the same incident, and the Israelis are just incensed about the hypocrisy of that from the United Nations. Meanwhile, John McCain, speaking of the incident with the president and Netanyahu and Congress, John McCain says relations with Israel are the worst I've ever seen. This is in Israel National News. He says President Obama has had unrealistic expectations of Israel. Yeah, that's a mouthful. And then there's a story also in Israel National News about American Israel haters are buying the government for the left. And there's actually a very well-funded campaign called the V15 campaign in Israel that is funded by American money, which is, it's actually trying to bring the left to power in Israel and get rid of Netanyahu. So, The alarm is sounded. We need to be in prayer for the next month or so, 5 weeks, until we come up to that election. There's an article on Breitbart News about another incident this week where the headline is "The Muslim Brotherhood Comes to the White House." And there's a picture of President Obama and his closest advisor, Valerie Jarrett, who is a Muslim Iranian American. Most people don't realize she's an Iranian American Muslim, and yet she is, has the ear of the president more than anybody else, most observers believe. No wonder the U.S. is giving away the farm to Iran in these negotiations. But this week, the White House held a meeting with 15 Muslim leaders and refused to give their names. It was a secret list until the press finally got through to them and they gave the list of names. It turns out several of them were directly connected to the Muslim Brotherhood, which is actually not a new thing. The president has been meeting with Muslim Brotherhood leaders throughout his administration. In fact, has Muslim Brotherhood advisors throughout the federal government. Even Hillary Clinton's right-hand woman is Huma Abedin, whose mother was the founder of the Muslim Sisterhood. So there are tentacles all throughout our government, a very serious situation. And of course, as I said, probably the biggest news that hit the West was the burning of the Jordanian pilot. But the next day, there's a report from Cameroon that the Nigerian Islamist group Boko Haram actually burned 90 civilians to death in Cameroon as sort of a copycat thing of what had happened with ISIS. It just shows how vile that demonic spirit is. It's a death cult, and it's not organized in the way that the West understands organizational charts and all of that. It's a spiritual connection because it's a demonic principality of death from hell. It's risen up out of the pits of hell into our world, and we better recognize that before it's too late in the West. And then there's a good article in the Israel National News, an opinion editorial by Giulio Miotti, an Italian journalist, who wrote, "What about the Christians and Israelis burned alive? Where is the collective outrage about all of those, including Americans, burned alive by terrorists? Is it because they were Jews and Christians?" Of course, we have heard some about that, but there's so much more that we haven't heard that because the Christians are being martyred all over the Arab world, the Muslim world. Just a quick mention in passing, we continue to have just conversations about strengthening our border in the southwest of the United States, but there's a full presentation of a new 800-meter border over off on northern part of Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is building this border fence that is twin chain link fences with razor wire. There's a moat. There are watchtowers. There's embankments to slow infiltrators. There's over 1.5 million meters of fiber optic cables with underground sensors and all kinds of things. And that seems to be okay for Saudi Arabia to do it, but for some reason we're not supposed to do that, something like that on our border. I think we should. Another one on Channel 7, there's a story here about Hamas conquers the University of California, there's the student body actually voted to boycott Israel, divest, and sanction Israel, and the students... The student senator gloats over the Hamas victory, he calls it. And hours later, there are swastikas on a Jewish fraternity house. And they're actually yelling, beep, beep, Akbar, which I don't say the name of the God of Islam. But they're using that as their rallying cry. There's a video that shows that and so forth. That's on the UC Davis campus, I believe it was, in California. And that's happening, though, on many college campuses in the United States. There's this rising anti-Semitism that is finding expression in among our young people. And that cannot speak well for the future. Article here about a job ad in France. A French anti-racism group files discrimination suit after a design website publishes an ad looking for a designer who is, quote, preferably not Jewish. This is 2015, folks, and we're seeing 1933 all over again, not only in Israel, but around the world. We better wake up. Another bad sign, the pro-Israeli Canadian Foreign Minister, John Baird, resigns. In fact, the predictions for the new elections coming up in Canada are that John Harper, the conservative who's been very outspoken and pro-Israel, visited Israel several times, he may be defeated by the left in Canada. And that's something that we also need to be praying about, be aware of. Some good stories. There's one in Israel Today magazine says a poll in Israel says most Israelis are interested in studying the Bible. Pretty neat. 54% of Jews say they only have a basic grasp of their national faith, and 57% would commit at least 5 minutes a day to reading the Bible. Hallelujah. That's what I'm talking about. We start seeing Israelis reading the Bible, you know God will get into that and speak to their hearts. Let's pray that that will happen. Jerusalem Post has an article publicly honoring Christians United for Israel, John Hagee's ministry that now has over 2 million members of Christians supporting Israel. Doreen and I are members of that, by the way. And I'm glad to see that it actually made the Jerusalem Post. It is the largest pro-Israel organization in the world. Outside of Israel, and well, even within Israel, I guess. So praise God for CUFI, Christians United for Israel. Interesting article on the Times of Israel. Palestinian Authority studies details of each terrorist act before issuing salaries. Newly obtained documents show meticulous process by which martyrdom status, payment levels, and honorary ranks are determined, as the Palestinian Authority actually uses money that is given to it, some of it even by the United States, to pay the terrorists and the martyrs and their families and so forth. And they rank them according to how rank the terrorist attack was, pun intended. Well, another thing that came out this week is that the European Union is actually helping to build illegal homes in the West Bank, actually in a suburb of Jerusalem, right on the edge of Male Adumim in what's called Area C. And they have been building prefab, really quick houses, trying to establish, quote, facts on the ground to say that Palestinians live there and they have a right to live there. But it's an area that's not legal to build on. Some of it's even nature preserves and so forth. And so the European Union is way over their head getting involved in that. Another story about Jerusalem's churches. There are a lot of old-line Christian churches in Jerusalem, but this story actually charges that hirelings have taken over and chased away the real shepherds, along with the true believers in many of these Christian institutions in Israel. It says Protestant church leaders send clergy to Jerusalem who work against the Jews and support the Muslims. Christians in Jerusalem must search in vain for Sunday services to worship the God of Israel. Of course, the corollary to that story is, on the other hand, the Messianic movement in Israel is growing, and there are plenty of Messianic congregations of Israel's Israeli Jews who love Jesus and are meeting and worshiping Him. In fact, some of those congregations actually have Jews and Arab Christians meeting together. And I say, God bless them. Let them continue to grow. Another article from Israel Today, the Knesset speaker, Yuli Edelstein, actually declared, he's the head of the Knesset, and he said the Bible is the Jews' deed to this land. And that's a really strong statement. I appreciate hearing that from him. And then by contrast, on the other side of the fence, it sounds like, headline in Breitbart News, when Obama spoke to the annual prayer dinner in D.C. this week, the headline says, Obama rips Bible, praises Quran. And of course, you've probably heard about that in the news as well. He tried to equivocate the attempts in the Crusades to repel the Muslim hordes who were invading Europe and had already taken over the Middle East and Jerusalem. And the Crusades were mounted to actually defeat Islam at that time. And he says that the Crusaders and Christians in general are just as bad as Muslims and these radical jihadists and so forth. Very shameful display at the prayer breakfast. Well, let me just finish with one little final kind of personal note. Doreen and I and a group of 14 of us are going to Jerusalem this week. We'll be leaving Tuesday and be gone for a couple weeks. I'm going to try to still get my reports out from our travels while we're traveling. But a little headline here on Israel National News says that Jerusalem may see snow next Thursday. I look at the forecast for the next week or so in Israel. It looks like a lot of rain and maybe even snow. Although on Thursday, we won't be in Jerusalem. We'll be in Tiberias in the north. But anyway, whatever it is, we'll praise God for it. We do pray for rain in the time of latter rain, according to Zechariah 10. So we'll rejoice even if it's raining. And I appreciate if you'd pray with us, pray for us as we travel. Thank you. Let's just close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your faithfulness. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We pray for rain in the time of latter rain, even if it affects our tour. And Lord, as we go on this tour, just give us authority. Anoint us, Lord, to prophesy to the land. This land, the deed of this land is given in the Bible. It belongs to Israel. You have given it to Israel. And your word is the final word. Thank you, Jehovah God. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you in the plan. Shalom, shalom.